接下来介绍一个各位同学大概觉得我不太可能介绍的东西，就是电玩。那这位Game Designer， 他的名字叫做 James McGonigal。 那这位呢现在大概三十几岁，他是一个 Game Designer， 是一个游戏的设计者。他是伯克莱大学的博士，他的博士研究的论文就是游戏，但是他的游戏不是在伯克莱研究说游戏怎么设计，而是他用游戏理论去研究如何透过游戏来拯救世界。这个听起来有点开玩笑，大家都说游戏是不好，每一天花那么多时间在游戏。他把这个事情想成另外一个层次，他认为人类在演化，那么从历史上来看，人类有很多的演化，最后演化到好的部分去。所以他认为游戏不是坏事，是坏游戏是坏事。所以如果你设计出一些好游戏，那么这些好游戏呢，就有可能可以拯救世界。那么我们可以从他的 Wikipedia 上面的一些介绍去了解这个人。他在这个除了目前除了在伯克莱教书以外，他当然设计 game， 但是他设计 game 的这个公司呢是一个非常特别的公司，它叫做Institute for the Future， 未来研究院。那么这个未来研究院它的这个帮助的客户有很多种，刚刚各位看到的那个游戏呢，就是世界银行委托他们设计的一个游戏。这个游戏是叫做 Evoke， Urgent Evoke， 用这个游戏只玩十个礼拜，参加的人玩十个礼拜，十个礼拜以后选出一些高手，这些高手呢，就世界银行给他们一些经费，让他们根据他们在游戏里面所展现出来的能力，去思考一些改变世界的方法。那因为游戏是可以全世界玩，而且游戏是可以跟不同的人合作，而且游戏有的时候不合作还达不到目标，所以透过这些游戏的活动里面，你可以看到谁是真正的领导者，谁是真正的有思考能力的人。那这个是他们这个团队在为他的客户设计游戏的时候的一些很特别的地方。我们来看一下他在 TED 里面的这支影片。
I'm Jane McGonigal. I'm a game designer. I've been making games online now for 10 years, and my goal for the next decade is to try to make it as easy to save the world in real life as it is to save the world in online games. Now, I
hope. 他的这个演讲在 TED 讲 ，TED 是有很多非常有思考的人，每一年花很多钱去听的地方。请他来讲，代表了一个。他在这一方面的思想是有一些观点，所以他会被邀请去讲。他的开场是说，他认为游戏可以救世界。那他认为他就是要设计出一些方法，让大家在实际的世界中间去解决世界现在的问题，就像在游戏的世界中间一样的得到很多的鼓舞，而且一样的。没有那么多的挫折感，所以我们来听他解释。
Now I have a plan for this, and it entails convincing more people, including all of you, to spend more time playing bigger and better games. Right now, we spend 3 billion hours a week playing online games. Some of you might be thinking, that's a lot of time to spend playing games. Maybe too much time, considering how many urgent problems we have to solve in the real world. But actually, according to my research at the Institute for the Future, it's actually the opposite is true. 3 billion hours a week is not nearly enough gameplay to solve the world's most urgent problems. In fact, I believe that if we want to survive the next century on this planet, we need to increase that total dramatically. I've calculated the total we need at 21 billion hours of gameplay every week.
现在全世界所有的各位玩游戏的举手，我看才两个，不可能吧？真的还假的？30亿小时，他认为要增加到210亿小时。
So that's probably a bit of a counterintuitive idea. So I'll say it again, let it sink in. If we want to solve problems like hunger, poverty, climate change, global conflict, obesity, I believe that we need to aspire to play games online for at least 21 billion hours a week by the end of the next decade. No, I'm serious. I am.Here's why. This picture pretty much sums up why I think games are so essential to the future survival of the human species. Truly. This is a portrait by a photographer named Phil Toldano. He wanted to capture the emotion of gaming. So he set up a camera in front of gamers while they were playing. And this is a classic gaming emotion. Now, if you're not a gamer, you might miss some of the nuance in this photo. You probably see the sense of urgency, a little bit of fear, but intense concentration.Deep, deep focus on tackling a really difficult problem. If you are a gamer, you will notice a few nuances here. The crinkle of the eyes up and around the mouth is a sign of optimism. And the eyebrows up is surprise. This is a gamer who's on the verge of something called an epic win. Now, oh, you've heard of that. Okay, good. So we have some gamers among us. So an epic win is an outcome that is so extraordinarily positive, you had no idea it was even possible until you achieved it. It was almost beyond the threshold of imagination. And when you get there, you're shocked to discover what you're truly capable of. That's an epic win. This is a gamer on the verge of an epic win. And this is the face that we need to see on millions of problem solvers all over the world as we try to tackle the obstacles of the next century. The face of someone who, against all odds, is on the verge of an epic win.
Now, 他在这一段里面讲了一个重要的概念，就是说，在游戏里面，有的时候你认为你不会赢的时候，结果被你熬过去了，或者是就是突破了。所以那个时候，如果你的表情被记录的时候，你除了这个惊恐，然后很紧张，非常的专注以外，你还有一个非常不可置信的，你居然有这个能力。他认为现实世界最重要的问题就是，我们都认为我们没有能力，我们认为我们没有能力解决饥荒的问题，我们认为这个问题太大，我们认为我们没有能力解决全球暖化的问题，我们认为这个问题太大，我们认为所有现在世界上认为该去做的问题，我们都认为这个问题太大，我们解决不了。在现实的世界里面，我们认为没有能力；在网络游戏的世界里面，我们认为我们有很多能力，而且我们不断的突破，而且我们每一次突破的时候，我们就会被升级，升成另外一种身份。所以你不断的被鼓励，那他认为这个是不通的。现实的世界，我们理论上应该有相同的能力。重点是说，我们在解决现实世界的问题的时候，用的系统是不对的，所以让每一个人都觉得充满了挫折。你的挫折感让你觉得你没有能力，而不是你真的没有能力。
Now, unfortunately,This is more of the face that we see in everyday life now as we try to tackle urgent problems. This is what I call the I'm not good at life face. And this is actually me making it. Can you see it? Yes, good. This is actually me making the I'm not good at life face. This is a piece of graffiti in my old neighborhood in Berkeley, California, where I did my PhD on why we're better in games than we are in real life. And this is a problem that a lot of gamers have.We feel that we are not as good in reality as we are in games. And I don't mean just good as in successful, although that's part of it. We do achieve more in game worlds. But I also mean good as in motivated to do something that matters, inspired to collaborate and to cooperate. And when we're in game worlds, I believe that many of us become the best version of ourselves, the most likely to help at a moment's notice, the most likely to stick with a problem as long as it takes, to get up after failure and try again. And in real life, When we face failure, when we confront obstacles, we often don't feel that way. We feel overcome. We feel overwhelmed. We feel anxious, maybe depressed, frustrated, or cynical. We never have those feelings when we're playing games. They just don't exist in games. So that's what I wanted to study when I was a graduate student. What about games makes it impossible to feel that we can't achieve everything? How can we take those feelings from games and apply them to real-world work? So I looked at games like World of Warcraft, which is really the ideal collaborative problem-solving environment. And I started to notice a few things that make epic wins so possible in online worlds. So the first thing is, whenever you show up in one of these online games, especially in World of Warcraft, there are lots and lots of different characters who are willing to trust you with a world-saving mission right away. But not just any mission. It's a mission that is perfectly matched with your current level in the game.
就是在你在游戏的时候，他不会出一个根本你现在就是一个初学者，他给你一个难题，那三下就把你打倒了，你根本就不想再继续玩下去了。所以他永远是看你是谁，我出什么题目给你，所以你会一直赢，一直赢，一直赢，所以你就一直想成功，一直想成功，一直想成功。可是，在真实世界在解决问题的时候，他不是这样设计的，所以你也可能一下就被打败，然后你就觉得啊，这不可能。这个是他认为，在未来如果我们能够把设计游戏的方法拿来解决世界问题的时候，他就会成功。这就是为什么他帮世界银行去设计10个礼拜解决10个就是世界上最大的问题，然后让他看到那些哪些人是领导人物，哪些人是真正有创意的人。
Right, so you can do it. They never give you a challenge that you can't achieve. But it is on the verge of what you're capable of, so you have to try hard. But there's no unemployment in World of Warcraft. There's no sitting around wringing your hands. There's always something specific and important to be done. And there are also tons of...
刚刚还有一句话，网络世界里面没有失业的人，也就是当你进到那里面，你总是在做一些事情，你不会说我失业了，在网络世界里面没事做，那是没有这个东西的。所以那个是你初听起来的时候，你会觉得讲什么啊，胡说八道。可是你仔细想的时候，你就会知道说，在这个整个系统概念里面是隐藏的一些东西，我们应该去深刻的思考。它配合着爱因斯坦，在我第一句话指出来的爱因斯坦的那一句话很重要。它就是说，不是要出一个题目把学生考倒，而是出一个题目以后，你看出来学生已经知道什么，或者是他不知道的事情，但是他有能力知道了。网络的游戏的设计的理论就是这样，他不能把你打倒，打倒了以后他就没生意做了。所以这个的重点就在这里。
Tons of collaborators everywhere you go, hundreds of thousands of people ready to work with you to achieve your epic mission. That's not something we have in real life that easily. The sense that at our fingertips are tons of collaborators.And also, there's this epic story, this inspiring story of why we're there and what we're doing. And then we get all this positive feedback. You guys have heard of leveling up and +1 strength and +1 intelligence. We don't get that kind of constant feedback in real life. When I get off the stage, I'm not going to have, you know, +1 speaking and +1 crazy idea, +20 crazy idea. I don't get that feedback in real life. Now, the problem with collaborative online environments like World of Warcraft,is that it's so satisfying to be on the verge of an epic win all the time that we decide to spend all our time in these game worlds. It's just better than reality. So far, collectively, all the World of Warcraft gamers have spent 5.93 million years solving the virtual problems of Azeroth. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. It might sound like it's a bad thing. But to put that in context, 5.93 million years ago was when our earliestprimate human ancestors stood up. That was the first upright primate. Okay, so when we talk about how much time we're currently investing in playing games, the only way it makes sense to even think about it is to talk about time at the magnitude of human evolution, which is an extraordinary thing, but it's also apt, because it turns out that by spending all this time playing games, we're actually changing what we are capable of as human beings. We're evolving to be a more collaborativeand hardy species. This is true, I believe this.
听懂了吗？他的意思就是说，500多万年前，我们人站起来，然后站起来以后花了很长的时间发展到现在。然后在网络上玩游戏的这些人，他加时间加起来也是500多万年了，因为他非常的集中在做这些事情。那看起来是一件坏事，可是这个如果 你想象他已经在演化他作为一个人的能力，可以变成他跟很多他不认识的人他都可以合作，是不是一件好事？是一件好事。他跟很多他愿意想尽各种办法去解决一件眼前看起来对他有挑战的事情，然后去克服他，是不是好事？是好事。所以他认为这些事情如果好好的去把它引导到一个对的地方去，那么这个人类本身的能力是在演化之中。
So consider this really interesting statistic. It was recently published by a researcher at Carnegie Mellon University. The average young person today in a country with a strong gamer culture will have spent 10,000 hours playing online games by the age of 21. Now, 10,000 hours is a really interesting number for two reasons. First of all, for children in the United States, 10,080 hours is the exact amount of time you will spend in school from fifth grade to high school graduation if you have perfect attendance. So we have an entire parallel track of education going on where young people are learning as much about what it takes to be a good gamer as they're learning about everything else in school. Now, some of you have probably read Malcolm Gladwell's new book, Outliers, so you would have heard of his theory of success.
听过我介绍那个 Outliers 这本书的同学举手，我看。好，所以你们都知道那个一万小时是什么意思。
The 10,000 hour theory of success. It's based on this great cognitive science research that if we can master 10,000 hours of effortful study at anything by the age of 21, we will be virtuosos at it. We will be as good at whatever we do as the greatest people in the world. And so now what we're looking at is an entire generation of young people who are virtuoso gamers. So the big question is, what exactly are gamers getting so good at? Because if we could figure that out, we would have a virtually unprecedented human resource on our hands. This is how many people we now have in the world who spend at least an hour a day playing online games. These are our virtuoso gamers. 500 million people who are extraordinarily good at something. And in the next decade, we're going to have another billion gamers who are extraordinarily good at whatever that is. If you don't know it already, this is coming. The game industry is developing consoles that are low energy and that work with the wireless phone networks instead of broadband internet so that gamers all over the world, particularly in India, China, Brazil, can get online. They expect 1 billion more gamers in the next decade. So it'll bring us up to 1.5 billion gamers. So I've started to think about what these games are making us virtuosos at. Here are the four things I came up with. The first is urgent optimism. Okay, think of this as extreme self-motivation. Urgent optimism is the desire to act immediately to tackle an obstacle combined with the belief that we have a reasonable hope of success. Gamers always believe that an epic win is possible and that it's always worth trying, and trying now. Gamers don't sit around. Okay, gamers are virtuosos at weaving a tight social fabric. There's a lot of interesting research that shows that we like people better after we play a game with them, even if they've beaten us badly. And the reason is it takes a lot of trust to play a game with someone. We trust that they will spend their time with us, that they will play by the same rules, value the same goal, they'll stay with the game until it's over. And so playing a game together actually builds up bonds and trust and cooperation, and we actually build stronger social relationships as a result. Blissful productivity, I love it. You know, there's a reason why the average World of Warcraft gamer plays for 22 hours a week, kind of a half-time job. It's because we know when we're playing a game that we're actually happier working hard than we are relaxing or hanging out. We know that we are optimized as human beings to do hard and meaningful work. And gamers are willing to work hard all the time if they're given the right work. Finally, epic meaning. Gamers love to be attached to awe-inspiring missions, to human planetary scale stories. So just one bit of trivia that helps put that into perspective. So you all know Wikipedia, biggest wiki in the world. Second biggest wiki in the world, with nearly 80,000 articles, is the World of Warcraft wiki. 5 million people use it every month. They have compiled more information about World of Warcraft on the internet than any other topic covered on any other wiki in the world. They are building an epic story. They are building an epic knowledge resource about the World of Warcraft. Okay, so these are four superpowers that add up to one thing. Gamers are super empowered, hopeful individuals. These are people who believe that they are individually capable of changing the world. And the only problem is they believe that they are capable of changing virtual worlds and not the real world. That's the problem that I'm trying to solve. There's an economist named Edward Castronova whose work is brilliant. He looks at why people are investing so much time and energy and money in online worlds. And he says, we're witnessing what amounts to no less than a mass exodus to virtual worlds and online game environments. And he's an economist, so he's rational. And he says, not like me, I'm a game designer, I'm exuberant. But he says that this makes perfect sense. Because gamers can achieve more in online worlds than they can in real life. They can have stronger social relationships in games than they can have in real life. They get better feedback and feel more rewarded in games than they do in real life. So he says, for now, it makes perfect sense for gamers to spend more time in virtual worlds than the real world. Now, I also agree that that is rational, for now, but it is not, by any means, an optimal situation. We have to start making the real world work more like a game.
Make the real world more like a game， 意思就是说把我们的真实世界改变的比较像是一个我们在游戏世界里面认识的那种世界，那个世界游戏规则不太一样，那个世界合作的方法不太一样，所以这是他的目标。
Something that happened 2500 years ago. These are ancient dice made out of sheep's knuckles, right? Before we had awesome game controllers, we had sheep's knuckles. And these represent the first game equipment designed by human beings. And if you're familiar with the work of the ancient Greek historian Herodotus, you might know this history, which is the history of who invented games and why. Herodotus says that games, particularly dice games, were invented in the kingdom of Lydia during a time of famine. Apparently, there was such a severe famine that the king of Lydia decided they had to do something crazy. People were suffering, people were fighting. It was an extreme situation, they needed an extreme solution. So, according to Herodotus, they invented dice games and they set up a kingdom-wide policy. On one day, everybody would eat. And on the next day, everybody would play games. And they would be so immersed in playing the dice games because games are so engaging and immerse us in such satisfying, blissful productivity, they would ignore the fact that they had no food to eat. And then on the next day, they would play games. And on the next day, they would eat. And according to Herodotus, they passed 18 years this way, surviving through a famine by eating on one day and playing games on the next. Now, this is exactly, I think, how we're using games today. We're using games to escape real-world suffering. We're using games to get away from everything that's broken in the real environment, everything that's not satisfying about real life, and we're getting what we need from games. But it doesn't have to end there. This is really exciting. According to Herodotus, after 18 years, the famine wasn't getting better, so the king decided they would play one final dice game. They divided the entire kingdom in half. They played one dice game, and the winners of that game got to go on an epic adventure. They would leave Lydia, and they would go out in search of a new place to live, leaving behind just enough people to survive on the resources that were available, and hopefully to take their civilization somewhere else where they could thrive. Now, this sounds crazy, right? But recently, DNA evidence has shown that the Etruscans, who then led to the Roman Empire, actually share the same DNA as the ancient Lydians. And so, recently, scientists have suggested that Herodotus' crazy story is actually true. And geologists have found evidence of a global cooling that lasted for nearly 20 years that could have explained the famine. So this crazy story might be true. They might have actually saved their culture by playing games, escaping to games for 18 years, and then been so inspired and knew so much about how to come together with games that they actually saved the entire civilization that way. Okay, we can do that. We've been playing Warcraft since 1994. That was the first real-time strategy game from the World of Warcraft series. That was 16 years ago. They played dice games for 18 years. We've been playing Warcraft for 16 years. I say we are ready for our own epic game. Now, they had half the civilization go off in search of a new world. So that's where I get my 21 billion hours a week of gameplay from. Let's get half of us to agree to spend an hour a day playing games until we solve real-world problems. Now, I know you're asking, how are we going to solve real-world problems in games? Well, that's what I have devoted my work to over the past few years at the Institute for the Future. We have this banner in our offices in Palo Alto, and it expresses our view of how we should try to relate to the future. We do not want to try to predict the future. What we want to do is make the future. We want to imagine the best case scenario outcome, and then we want to empower people to make that outcome a reality. We want to imagine epic wins, and then give people the means to achieve the epic win. I'm just going to very briefly show you three games that I've made that are an attempt to give people the means to create epic wins in their own futures. So this is World Without Oil. We made this game in 2007. This is an online game in which you try to survive an oil shortage. The oil shortage is fictional, but we put enough online content out there for you to believe that it's real and to live your real life as if we've run out of oil. So when you come to the game, you sign up, you tell us where you live, and then we give you real-time news videos, data feeds that show you exactly how much oil costs, what's not available, how food supply is being affected, how transportation is being affected, if schools are closed, if there's rioting. And you have to figure out how you would live your real life as if this were true. And then we ask you to blog about it, to post videos, to post photos. We piloted this game with 1,700 players in 2007, and we've tracked them for the 3 years since. And I can tell you that this is a transformative experience. Nobody wants to change how they live just because it's good for the world or because we're supposed to. But if you immerse them in an epic adventure and tell them, we've run out of oil, this is an amazing story and adventure for you to go on. Challenge yourself to see how you would survive. Most of our players have kept up the habits that they learned in this game. So for the next world-saving game, we decided to aim higher, bigger problem than just peak oil. We did a game called Superstruct at the Institute for the Future. And the premise was a supercomputer has calculated that humans have only 23 years left on the planet. The supercomputer was called the Global Extinction Awareness System, of course. And we asked people to come online, almost like a Jerry Bruckheimer movie. You know Jerry Bruckheimer movies? You form a dream team, you've got the astronaut, the scientist, the ex-convict, and they all have something to do to save the world. But in our game, instead of just having five people on the dream team, we said everybody's on the dream team, and it's your job to invent the future of energy, the future of food, the future of health, the future of security, and the future of the social safety net. We had 8,000 people play that game for 8 weeks. They came up with 500 insanely creative solutions that you can go online if you Google Superstruct and see. So finally, the last game. We're launching it March 3rd. This is a game done with the World Bank Institute. If you complete the game, you will be certified by the World Bank Institute as a social innovator, class of 2010, working with universities all over sub-Saharan Africa, and we are inviting them to learn social innovation skills. We've got a graphic novel, we've got leveling up in skills like local insight, knowledge networking, sustainability, vision, and resourcefulness. I would like to invite all of you to please share this game with young people anywhere in the world, particularly in developing areas, who might benefit from coming together to try to start to imagine their own social enterprises to save the world. So I'm going to wrap up now. I want to ask a question. What do you think happens next? We've got all these amazing gamers. We've got these games that are kind of pilots of what we might do, but none of them have saved the real world yet. Well, I hope that you will agree with me that gamers are a human resource that we can use to do real-world work, that games are a powerful platform for change. We have all these amazing superpowers, blissful productivity, the ability to weave a tight social fabric, this feeling of urgent optimism and the desire for epic meaning. I really hope that we can come together to play games that matter, to survive on this planet for another century, and that's my hope that you will join me in making and playing games like this. When I look forward to the next decade, I know two things for sure. That we can make any future we can imagine, and we can play any games we want. So I say, let the world-changing games begin. Thank you. Thank you.
A very interesting 那么从一个看起来书不是随便念的人，他去研究一个大家都觉得如果把太多的心血放在上面，就会是一个问题的一个叫做网络游戏。这个影片 我在看完的时候思考了大概两天，决定要不要拿来当成上课的材料。两天以后，我觉得这个影片很重要的是在告诉我们，世界变成了一个不一样的地方。这个不一样的地方就是说，全球现在有5亿人在玩网络游戏，网络游戏花的时间非常的长，而且它需要非常的专注。那么这种花很长的时间很专注的做一件事情，跟花很长的时间去练好一首钢琴曲，或者是练好这个篮球的投篮，没有什么太大的两样。那么专注然后长时间的练习这件事情，能够让这个人基本上有了一些改变。那当改变的人已经累积到这么多，而且越来越多人在网络上面玩游戏的时候，照刚刚他的资料是未来的十年就有15亿人，就是大概70亿人里面有15亿人在网络上面玩游戏。那么这种游戏的特质，如果照他刚刚说的，就是说他跟真实的世界里面最大的不同，就是他可以合作，然后他比较乐观。那么，所以是不是我们真的可以去思考，透过游戏所产生的能力，以及游戏能够吸引人专注于一个问题的这种特质，我们真正的世界问题应该不再用传统的方法去解决，而是应该用游戏的方法去解决。这个就是后来我决定要把这个影片放来当成一个教材的一个原因。那么也让大家看到世界银行的这个网站是什么样的东西。所以游戏救世界还是游戏害世界，这个趋势的思考，我觉得是值得各位在座的同学好好的去思考。事实上是有很多人玩了游戏以后，因为沉迷了以后，他的人生就因为这样子而遭受到破坏。可是如果我们真正的了解它不是游戏的错误，而是他沉迷的方法的错误，那么说不定我们就会对游戏有一种不太一样的看法。那么这样子的一个东西，我们怎么样子拿来变成是一个改变世界的方式，或者是改变世界的一个平台，或者是改变世界的一个能力？我想今天刚刚的那位这个 game designer， 他多多少少让我们开始去思考一个我们原来怎么样都不会想象的一个题目。我们通常想象的是游戏害世界的这个角度，我们通常不太容易去想象游戏救世界的这个角度。那么他也很勇敢，他在伯克莱大学的博士论文写的就是游戏可以救世界的这个角度。那么去研究为什么人在真实生活里面没有在网络玩游戏的时候那么的快乐，为什么你叫一个年轻人不要去玩网络游戏的时候，你会那么的不容易去要求他停止。这中间他透过经济学家的分析，透过其他等等的分析，让我们看到一个不一样的世界正在形成。所以这也是我今天想要跟各位在谈娱乐这样子的一个未来10年、20年、30年的发展的时候，特别把它排在第二个这个教育的第二字里面，娱乐的第二字里面，让我们去思考。